been a long time.
August the 10th, almost, wow, close to 90 days. It was a freak accident. I'll have my daughter explain. The 17 days that I was unconscious, and she sort of did well at my bedside. And when the lab said, you're not going to make it, the percentage of recovery is less than single digits. And she didn't give up. My sister Harriet didn't give up. Kathy, my wife, didn't give up. For 17 days, finally, I came out of this terrible nightmare that I was in. And so I talked about the Russian submarine out there. I don't know why you get drugs like that. But then I decided to, come to and make some sense and eventually was discharged on my way. Now I'm in therapy, very extensive therapy, aggressive. If I want to walk again, and I do, I want to walk without a limp, which is another issue that I deal with because of my knee was busted. I've got to do some serious, serious therapy. And I'm trying to say this without crying, but today I walked 168 steps on my own. So, and the reason I get emotional about that accomplishment, it's only been 7 days since I left this other facility where I wasn't getting a whole lot of, I wasn't seeing any progress. And 7 days I've been in the hands of this, I call him Attila the Hun, but and he's already getting that kind of success. And the reason I get emotional at all is because I can help see through the therapy that at the end, a month, 2 years, I'll be walking into this room to greet all of you. That's my goal, obviously. I'm here with an immediate attendance, and so I know this. I'm not trying to couch my words at all, but I want to thank the staff that is here. I see so many of the managers and supervisors who carried on in my long absence. Wasn't intended to be that way, but stuff happens. And yet, I got daily briefings from my top staff who came to McLaren, who came to the Rehabilitation Institute, who came to the place in Harper, I've never bounced around for all these different specialties. And every day, Jerry, Phil, and some of the top staff would be there and say, this is what happened today, these are the challenges today. And I would say, you want to get on my submarine? but I was getting well advised of the office and things they were doing that you all as managers. It was seamless. Now, I don't like when my staff takes a vacation for 2 weeks because I miss that individual. I was gone for close to 90 days, and yet you took the pressure, you understood, not a complaint, and the workload was there, and you just made yourself proud, made me proud. So the reason I wanted to meet with you my first day back was just to say thank you. Thank you for not only the job that you did, but at so many times and prayers and good wishes from all of you. I say it once, I thought it was pretty cool. If I can bring it up here. Technology is my middle name. Now here it is. Welcome back, Brooks. So very glad to hear, with apologies to Mark Twain, reports of your demise were greatly exaggerated. Many folks, all of all stripes, have held you in their thoughts and prayers, including me. Glad you're doing better, back to work. Best to you, and a full speed recovery, signed Dave Colton. So we're getting wishes and prayers from Democrats, Republicans, Independents. Got a nice mass card from John Ingram, and just didn't stop. And that's the kind of support that I guess I needed to beat the odds and to be sitting here while on my way to recover. Somebody asked about the injuries I sustained, and I finally made a list because I keep getting confused. And when I see the paper, it says Brooks bumped his head. A little more than that. I broke my ankle.
broke my knee. I fractured my left hip. There's a pin in my left femur. I had 5 broken wrists and 2 compound fractures of my wrist where I hit the airbag. So I had a litany of breaks, and at some point in time, the research says when you have more than 4 long bones broken, and I had 7, your odds are less than 90%, or 9%, so 10% survive, 9% you can claim that accident. So I had all the odds against me, but I had all the prayers working.
So you guys, not only are great employees for Oakland County, but you're just a great support for me, personally, for my family. Those 17 days, I had no idea. I was out, and my daughter Mary sat there, going in at the 9th month, and she certainly didn't need any tragedy in her life at this very important time. And I asked her to come here, and some of you know the others. She's a delightful girl, she's married, this is number 4. She was a teacher in Waterford, and I wanted her, at her own pace, at her own depth, give you some insights to what she saw and what she was feeling, because we had that first discussion Friday, the things that were going through her head, and she lost her brother, I lost my son, and she couldn't tolerate something like that again, and so she was suffering those 17 days. I want you to share some of that with us.
Okay. That's a little bit hard, you're a little sun up there. I hope you can understand him. I've been prepping him all week to speak clearly and loudly.
Well, my son, the car driver said, don't take any of these pain pills because it screws up your ability to speak. And I disregarded what he said and I took the pain pills. I told him I'm going to go in and I'm going to deal with this with Patterson, one swell poop.
We knew Dad was back when the jokes started coming. Okay, so like he said, I'm just going to talk off the cuff here. I really don't have anything prepared. Saturday I went and visited him at home, and now that he's clear in the head, it's nice to have him back and just to talk to him and tell him what he missed. Just in the world in general, we kind of came first. Dad, you missed the closing ceremonies of the Olympics. It's kind of where we left off, and then everything that came after that. But the other day was just him and I sitting down, and I just wasn't planning on it, but we just started to talk about things that happened in ICU. And my count was 18 days, not 17, but who's counting that either? So he was just astonished at the things that happened and the ups and the downs that we endured. I think we did tell him a couple weeks ago, but we'll keep telling him. The first thing I want to make clear, and Dad knows this, is that this was a pure act of God and a pure miracle that he's here, and even the doctors have told us that. Thank God the doctors told us later that anybody that breaks all 4 extremities has less than 10% chance to live. And they told us that after Dad had already passed that scary time, thank God. And then just recently, the doctors told us when they sat down and talked about Dad's condition and where he was at the time, they gave him a 3% chance to live. So there's no other explanation as for me and my family is that it was Dad's will to be here and God's will. And I told Dad on Saturday, I said, you obviously have a reason to be here. There's a reason you live. There's something else that you need to do. And he said to me, I've done the Dobson Open, which is something I'm very proud of, and I've done the Brooksy Way, which I'm very proud of, and I have some other great ideas that I need to do before I'm done. So as his daughter, I can't wait just to see the things that he's going to cook up for us in the next few years. First of all, I need to personally just thank the people from McLaren. This is not anything but just a daughter saying thank you for saving her dad. From the nurses that came in and changed the sheets and the gross things they have to take care of, all the way up to the top head doctors that would come in and sit with us and explain in layman terms what was happening to him and why he was doing the things he was doing, and what the next surgery was going to happen, and all that, all the way up to the management team at McLaren. I mean, they were honestly the best group of people I've ever met in my life. Even the nurses would say, we're not treating him any different because of who he is in the media. We're treating him like this because he's a very critical patient, and that's how we treat everybody. And they saved his life, there's no doubt about it. I also want to just say really quick before I get into some stories, I want to thank my mom. who has been at my dad's side every single day since this accident happened, and she said, I'm gonna take whatever it takes to get him back to where he was is what I'm gonna do. My mom and dad are divorced, but they have the best relationship as friends that you could, and people get confused all the time. Aren't your parents divorced? yeah, they are, but they're best friends. And so they're a true testament of friendship, and they're just a great example to their kids. But her and my Aunt Harriet, my dad's sister, my brother Dane, and then his close friends here at work were there every single day, including myself when I could. I have three little ones at home, but we were there every day. And there was a lot to endure. One story that I told Dad on Saturday that blew his mind was, it was I think a week after the accident, almost to the, I think to the day. And he had got his first surgery the night of the accident on his femur and knee, and he did really well with that. And then the next came the hip and the wrist. And at each surgery, they had to vent him. That was just a thing that they had told us. He has to be on a ventilator for these surgeries. It is just how it is with anybody. And but anytime a patient goes on a ventilator, it's very dangerous, and there's lots of things that can happen. But he would go off them a day or two. The first surgery, he went off immediately, which was great. The second surgery took him a day or two. So we thought the ventilator was behind us. And there's so many things that can come with a person on a ventilator, especially at the age of my father and his prior health. You know, he's not 100%, but he's pretty good. But they tell us there's things that can happen. You know, their lungs can fail, and he's laying down this whole time. He's been, you know, he hasn't, all these things. So it was a Friday afternoon, and I got the call that Dad had a good day, he was good, and this whole time now, you gotta remember, he's comatose, he's out, there's nothing going on here but him out 7 days after the surgery, after the accident. And I got a call from my mom saying that Dad has, something's happened, we don't really know, but they came in and they have to put a ventilator in Dad. His breathing has gone down, we don't know what's happening. So basically Dad is taking the turn for the worst. And here he was thinking, okay, the surgeries were behind him, now we're just gonna, you know, get through this. In a couple days, the medicine's gonna come down and he's gonna come out of it. That's kind of what we were thinking. So when they got the call that Dad was gonna be vented, we really didn't know what was happening. It was a Friday afternoon. And my brother had told me, you don't come up here, you don't wanna see Dad on a ventilator, you don't wanna see anybody on a ventilator. And my mom had been there every day, and so she said, I'm gonna come home. They said he just needs to sleep this, you know, he needs to go down for the weekend and just be vented. So it was very confusing of what happened and why, but I didn't want to see him on a ventilator, so I didn't go that Friday or that Saturday. We thought he'd be off by Saturday or Sunday. Sunday morning, he was still on a ventilator, and I said to my husband, I want to go. I don't care. I want to see him. I don't care if he's on a ventilator. So myself and my husband, my brother Dane, and his wife Heather all went to the hospital. We went in, and you know, it's like what you see on the movies, you know, the guy with the ventilator, the tubes, and his chest is going up and down, and he looked pretty bad. We're standing there just kind of praying over him and crying and thinking, what's going on? And the head doctor came in, I think her name was Dr. Kaiser. She's the head ICU doctor at McLaren. Really great lady, we got to know her. And she said, can I talk to you guys in private, you know, in my office or down the hall? And we said, okay, you know, this isn't good, this isn't going where you want it to go. So we went down to her office, and at that time she said, I think your dad needs to be put on a trach. He needs to... we need to do this immediately. We're thinking tomorrow morning. This was like Sunday evening, so she said, tomorrow morning we're going to take the ventilator out, put a trach in his throat. That way, he can, if he needs to be vented immediately again, like this afternoon, then we can do it quicker. We can clear out his lungs, and he won't have to go through the agony of sucking it out of his mouth. All these things, all these positive reasons of why it would be good for his health to get a trach. Well, my brother and I were like, well, will he be able to speak again? This is important to him. We know what's important to him. Will he be able to speak? She said, well, yeah, you know, most people do. So we had to go up with the ups and downs. My brother was had to sign off on everything, so he had to make the final decision. And we sat down, and we called a doctor at McLaren personally and asked, what does she think we should do? Then we called another doctor, and we just called everybody who we could, and they all said, I think it's a good idea for the medical reasons of what I just told you. Here I am crying, and I said to the doctor, you just need to tell me right now, is he going to die? Because I have to prepare myself. I'm, 7 months pregnant. I just lost my brother from an accident. I gotta be ready for this, so just, give it to me straight. And she said, she said, I don't think so. She said, I lost my father recently, and this is what I would do for him. And right now, I think, you know, at where we're at today, I think, no, I don't think he's going to die. And I said, okay, then I can do this. Let's put the trach in, you know. And she said, he won't. But the thing with the trach is you can't just put it in and then take it out. It's going to be in for a few weeks, 6 weeks possibly. He won't be able to talk when he wakes up. Then he'll eventually have to push a button to talk. Then eventually he'll be able to learn to talk with it. So this is like a long-term thing. And I knew if he woke up and hit a trach, we had a whole other issue to deal with. Yeah, I can't talk. So, I mean, and we were worried about that. We were thinking of long-term things for Dad, you know. So anyways, as we're having this conversation, I kid you not, as I'm sitting here crying, asking this doctor, is he going to die? There's a knock on her door, and a nurse pops her head in and says, patient six just tongued out his ventilator. And I looked at my brother and I said, is Dad patient six? I said, I think he is. So this doctor gets up and runs, and we follow her, and you know, sure as heck, it's Dad. She goes in, and they kind of kick us out, and we're out in the hallway going, what does that mean? He tongued out a ventilator. How do you tongue out a ventilator? And so she came out, and she said, he just spit out his ventilator. No, folks, you know, a ventilator goes down into your lungs. It's in your body. And she said it had to have taken him all day to tongue that thing out. And it was, you know, we were just like, kind of like, my brother and I didn't want to high-five each other yet, but we were like, so what does this mean? You know, so then the doctor came out, and she said, his oxygen's at 100%. Let's just see what happens. And I said, okay. In that meeting, she said, your dad's not coughing. It's very important that a patient has to cough. They have to clear their own lungs. If he doesn't clear his own lungs, we are going to have to trach him by the morning. And we said, all right. I kid you not, folks, again, another miracle. I walked in, he starts coughing. So we prop him up in his bed, and we're screaming at him, even though he's like comatose. We're, Dad, cough, cough, cough. And he was just coughing and coughing and coughing. And my brother and I are looking at each other, and I said to my brother who has to sign up, I said, don't sign that paper yet. Don't sign that paper yet. Give him time. Give him time. So that night, we stayed, and same thing, his oxygen was like 98, 99, 100. It just stayed right there. And the nurses were seriously, they had no words to explain this. And I believe in the Lord, and I remember praying in that office, in that doctor's office, just saying, please don't make him, let him get a trach. Please don't let trach him. Please don't trach him. And it was like one answered prayer immediately. He was not going to get that trach. So that was one of those cool moments. I think it was my dad's will, obviously. He tongued out a ventilator. It doesn't happen every day. It was God's will that, you know, he's going to be here. He's back. He's strong. And we're going to make it through this. And that was my moment of, okay, we can do this. We can do this. He can do this. It's all going to work.
My daughter said, Dad, what can I say? Honey, I got to go back to work
on something. So that's a good story. And then I one more quick story was, you know, people have been giving him shots in the media about, you know, is he ready and is he going to come back and all that good stuff. And it, throughout this whole thing, I would pray, like, just let him go back to work. That's all he wants to do. I just know my dad, and he just wants to work. Give him back his job. Please don't take away his job. He's meant to do his job. This is all he loves in life, is his job. And like when the trach came up, the first question was, will he be able to speak again? That is part of his life. He has to be able to speak again. So one funny story was at his last rehabilitation center, where he was for a few weeks, there was a whiteboard when you walked in. And it had like his doctor and the nurse on call and then his OT and his PT and, you know, things he could do on his own and things he couldn't do on his own. And then it had like a personal section, which most hospitals don't have. And you don't even know this, I don't know, because I didn't tell you on Saturday. But this is a funny part. You know, it had his name, and then it said, I had one other personal thing. Oh, what's your goal here in this facility? And his was to walk again. And the next one says, what's your favorite thing? And his, it wasn't me, it wasn't his children or his 10 grandchildren that he has or vacationing or anything. My favorite thing, my job. So that's him right there. He loves his job, he loves the people he works with. I always say, you know, there's four children in our family, but really there was five. Oakland County is the fifth child that he probably loves the most. But so there's no doubt that he is ready. We have had to literally hold him back from being here. So we finally got to the point where we're like, okay, I feel like I'm dropping my son off his first day of school. So be nice to him. Don't push him too hard. You know, don't wear him out. He's ready.
That kind of support, it's clear why I'm sitting here and well on my way to full recovery. Enough family stories, enough thank yous. You know I mean what I say. I thank all of you in the media. You guys and gals have been extremely patient. You've called, and my office has said, look, give them some time. I have time. So if you want to do one-on-ones later, if you want to come out to the house, I owe you a lot because you gave me 80 days to the world of unobtrusiveness, and I needed that time to sleep and mend and pray and all the things you do. So what I was going through. And so I owe you as well thanks and access, and so that's there for you. I'll take some questions for the media now, and then I'll let you all leave, and I want to finish my staff meeting, but
Brooks, a couple of things. How much do you think you can actually work, and what's the sort of the ramp up to getting back to a full day schedule? I guess that's the first question. The second one is, how much of the accident do you actually remember?
I'll take the second part first. I don't remember a thing, and I'm not trying to go back and reconstruct. I'm sure it was watching the picture of the car. I have no idea what happened. That was a Friday. I remember that. And I remember that morning I was at the Aniamos in Bloomfield for a unity rally for candidates. That's the last memory I have until I came out of my home and took people for a ride in my submarine. As far as getting back to work, I really never left work. I mean, physically I've been gone, but I've been there making decisions and some tough calls where, you know, that's how I operate my office. I really do delegate to my staff. They have a lot of authority to make decisions out of their own. I'm not a micromanager. I reserve the right to break ties, and certainly I reserve the right to call decisions when it deals with policy as opposed to program. And so that we maintain that. And so I'm well aware that how my staff did with the intervention conference, 400 attendees at the Royal Park, 700 total tuned in from around the world, including Thailand. First conference of its type for medical mainstream. Huge success. I sat and I wrote that baby. I'm well aware of the Brooksy Way and honoring my son. I'm well aware of the unemployment numbers and how they fluctuated and dropped to like 6.6 points this past week. So I'm on top of it. I'm lucky that I've got a staff who are extremely competent, and yet they're also well aware that I want to be hands-on to the extent that I can. So I'm back. I don't think we listed me.
Mr. Patterson, a lot of people, Rupert Raj here at Fox 2, I'm sitting in the back. Nice to see you. Welcome back.
Thank you.
Everyone's glad to see you. You know, running for office is a full-time job, many people say, in itself. Here you are trying to ramp up back to full speed in the job you have as executive. How will you balance a campaign and that at the same time?
Good question, Raj. If I was starting out facing my first four-year term as prosecutor, my first four-year term as county executive, I'd be in a lot of doo-doo. I've missed the whole campaign season. I'm ending my 20th year. People know me. I'm been well vetted by the voters. I've seen some polls that my campaign has done. My name ID, I think, is about 99 or 98. People say, why don't you get some signs out for those that 2%? I know where they live. So I'm in good shape, I can still run a campaign. We put out, and Jennifer's sitting right there, I saw Jennifer, but 175,000 pieces of literature, and you can still run a campaign in absentia, although that's not the way I want to do it. You know me better than that, but I'll be just fine on election day.
Mr. Patterson?
Yeah, sure.
What's the first thing you remember from waking up, and what's the first thing you said?
I'm not kidding. Talk about my submarine. I came out of, it could be 17, 18 days where I was just absolute, and I was still on heavy medication. And I was trying to talk. And I explained myself, I don't have to take a pill today. But, I see you there, and I want to talk to you. My conversation is going out over here. First thing I remember was trying to talk, and I couldn't control the comments. And that was sure.
Right when he did wake up, I remember it was a Tuesday, and my brother and I were there, and my husband, and he came out, and he was heavily medicated and everything, but he was looking around at us, and he started to cry, and he said, does anybody know I'm here? Do they know I'm gone? You know, what day is it? You know, we think we told him how many days it was, and he started crying. Do they know I'm gone? Does anybody care? Does anyone know? I was like, Dad, we have had to, the sheriff's office has had to help us keep these people back. Everyone wants to come up here and see you. So it was a very touching moment. He was crying and he wanted to know you know, does anybody care about me?
You could have gone without saying that.
I can tell a lot more.
When you come out of something where I was as bad, banged up with all these, you're on high dose, and that takes a while, maybe a week or two. Then, I suppose conversation with the family. I can't pinpoint it, but because they were present. But you really don't know that first day where you have that voila moment, you know.
What about this brick and mortar building, Mr. Patterson, right here where you are? You can do a lot of work from home, you can do a lot of work from a hospital, but now that you're here, what are some of the things that you couldn't do from there that you are looking forward to getting into here?
Well, I'm sort of a manager by management by walking around. I love to go down to the office and talk to my friends. I see them all nodding. I like to go to the office and get it firsthand. I'd like to think that I'm progressive, and my IT department won another award this year for being the most digitally progressive IT department in America. So we do focus and invest in IT, and yet I'm not a big fan of what's that kind of work?
Telecommuting?
Huh? Telecommuting. I can't say it. People stay at home and they do their work from home. Well, I can't see them. I want to go down the hall and have a cup of coffee with them. So I'm a hands-on kind of a manager. That's what I can do when I get back here. That part I've missed.
Yeah. Can you talk a little bit about the seatbelt issue and the lesson that you learned?
Next question, please. it was stupid. I probably wore it when I was on I-75 for long distance trips. Like, nothing happens close to home. It's when you're on the expressway. So I would belt up for trips, but you know, not these little runs across town. And we were going down, I think, Walton, if I'm mistaken. And I don't want to give the driver a way out because he blew that light, changed three lives, crippled one and changed mine. It's just, you know, thoughts through, I'm not making excuses for him. But yeah, I think, I was told this, I'll go there sometime, take a look myself. They put in a new kind of device, a blinking yellow, and people don't know that does not give you the right of way. And he shot through that at full speed, you know, just previous. If I hadn't built, I'm not sure I would have sustained some injuries, which was, I don't know. But I will say this, I was wrong. My interpretation of where the accidents happened was woefully incorrect. And I have made a commitment to wear the belt every day going forward. And if I have to come the poster boy for, you know, click it or lose it, I'll do it. Because, you know, I think that in the final analysis, that it does save some lives and certainly will save some bones.
Mr. Patterson, Smitho at Channel 7 News. Knowing that you only had maybe a 3-10% chance to make it post these injuries, does this change any of your priorities, and what will we see in the coming weeks, if not years?
It changes. I mean, that's a good question. It changes your priorities. Not as far as work. I'm still committed to this job, and I love the job, as Mary said. But, you know, I've got four kids. I had four, now I got three. That brings that into focus. Life really is pretty fleeting. I could have been gone that night. And with a lot of things I wanted to say to my kids, a lot of hugs and kisses I never would have had a chance to give. So, a lot of trips. I believe these, what I call memory trips. I could take my family places, and I'll have that memory when I am gone.
Big one.
What's that?
Big trip.
Oh, I owe you a big trip. And so all those things would have been left undone. I realize that. So my family was close before, but I don't think they'd be any closer than I am with my family today. And then I got, you know, everybody in this room knows I don't walk around with my religion on my sleeve. You probably don't even know what my religion is. I'm Roman Catholic. But you do, you know, have some conversations with God. You really will. So it's changed your perspective on the importance of religion and having the influence of God in your life. And, you know, so and that's how it probably changed. More so focus on family, religion. I've always had to focus on the job.
Thank you.